Hello, this is John from caveofprogramming.com. This is the final video in my C++ for Beginners course, or it's the final video in this beginner section of the course if you're watching a bundled version of this course. And in this video, I want to talk about a little bit about what you can do next if you've studied my beginner's course, or you've got a grasp on basic C++, what should you look at next? So there are some important C++ features that I haven't covered in this course. In fact, C++ has just a huge array of features, and of course the whole topic of programming in general is massive. So far in this course, we've covered C++ up to the point where you can make pretty complicated programs. In fact, you can do really a wide range of things with your software using the features we've covered so far. But there are features that enable you to do other things, or enable you to do things perhaps in a more elegant manner sometimes. And some of those are very important features that we haven't covered as well. So one feature that's worth studying in C++ is exceptions. This is an error handling mechanism. Many C++ programs are written entirely without exceptions. Some programmers just hate them, some C++ programmers, although they are key to the way Java works. In C++, they're less important, but still well worth studying because they're an extra thing you can use. And there are some things that are just easier to do with exceptions in C++. They enable you to catch errors that you may otherwise miss. We haven't looked at file handling, the business of reading and writing files. And again, this is an important topic in C++. And we haven't looked at the standard template library, STL. This sounds really intimidating, but in fact, it's not too complicated at all, and it's well worth learning because the STL gives you facilities for working with data that if you did them using lower level C++ features would be cumbersome and difficult to do. For example, STL gives you resizable arrays known as vectors, and as we've seen, you can't resize normal C++ arrays. So there are many other features as well that we haven't covered, but I've picked out these three as being the most important additions to this course for a beginner to study. Another thing you might want to consider looking at is C++ 11. Periodically, C++ has updates to its standard, which people then go away and implement into the compilers. And the most recent one, it's now nearly 2015, was C++ 11. In this course, we've covered C++ 98. And the reason for that is that, as far as I can tell, even now, when it's almost 2015, C++ 98, as far as I can tell, is the most widely used version of C++. C++ 11 adds more interesting features, which are doubtless going to be used more and more as time goes by. Companies tend to be quite slow to change code that they've developed and to move to new versions of compilers, but they get there eventually. So this is something very interesting that you might want to look at. One of the most important things you can do, apart from learning new features, perhaps the most important thing really, is to practice C++. A lot of people point out that it's really good to read existing well-written programs, but most of us find that most of the time just too boring and too difficult. And trying to write your own programs for most of us is more exciting, and it's absolutely vital. Whatever you do, it's vital that you try to write C++ programs, and that involves thinking up programs that you'd like to write and just having a go at writing them. It's best to start with programs that are very small and unambitious, and then gradually tackle more and more ambitious programs as you get a sense of what's really involved. One thing beginners often do is try to write something really ambitious, like a 3D game or something, and then they just never finish it because it's too difficult. So start small and work up. Games actually give you an incredibly good workout with C++. So even if you're not that interested in games and they've kind of ceased to interest me myself all that much, but I still write them sometimes, or try to. I don't always finish them actually, but I like to have a go at games because they really do give you an incredibly good workout. They really kind of tax your skills and push you to think more and more about the different features you can add to your program. But again, it's important to start with a really, really simple game, or maybe something that isn't even yet a game but shows some features of games, like our particle simulation that we've developed in this course, for example. And then to add on features once you've got something that you can say is complete, even if it doesn't do anything very exciting. It's better to always work towards a complete program and then add on more features later, rather than devise an incredibly ambitious program that won't be complete until you've done months or years of programming. My plan now is to create an advanced C++ course, which may be available by the time you're watching this video, and you'll be able to find that at caveofprogramming.com. Now, this course won't be free, but I have a standing offer that if you want this course, you feel you need it, and you just can't afford to pay because you're unemployed or whatever, or you're a student, maybe you haven't got any spare cash, then if you contact me via my website, I will give you a free copy of this course. But if you want this course and you can afford to pay for it, then I'd be very, very grateful if you would do, because this is how I make my living at the moment, by selling courses. And of course, there's just a huge amount of free material on C++ on the internet. No one needs a video course to learn C++, but this is kind of a convenience that a lot of people enjoy, rather than looking at text. And hopefully the advantage of these courses is that I can show you in front of you exactly what you have to do to get your program working. But absolutely, you can learn anything you need to know about C++ just from doing Googling and looking up free tutorials on YouTube, and just text-based tutorials as well. But this advanced course is going to be available if you want it, and I hope you'll consider purchasing it. I'll be grateful to you. Okay, so that's it for this tutorial and for this course, or this section of the course, if I bundled this with my advanced course somewhere. I hope you get a lot of pleasure out of devising and writing programs. It's a great hobby to get into, and of course you can get a job if you learn C++ by yourself, which is what I did. And I don't have a degree in it or anything, but I studied C++ and eventually got a job doing it. Okay, so until next time, happy coding.